Welcome, friends. Welcome back to the kitchen. Welcome back to Sunday morning in the old cookbook show. I looked at the calendar and realized that Christmas Eve this year was Sunday. So it's early December, and I'm racking my brain, what should I do for Christmas Eve? And I thought, I wish I could do Christmas cake again. This is our fruitcake that I call Christmas cake. I know for a lot of people, Christmas cake has to have that marzipan layer on top or some sort of icing. I don't like the icing, so I just make this Christmas cake every year. And you can find this fruitcake recipe elsewhere on our channel. We make that every year, early November. Usually doesn't last until Christmas Day. That is the last piece that I need to save for Christmas Day to share with others. And I started thinking about fruitcakes. And I realized that, you know, fruitcake, the farther back you go in time, almost every cake is a fruitcake. Dried fruit was definitely a big part of every cake. And cake, when you get earlier than, say, 1900, cake is completely different than what we associate today with cake in 2023. With what we associate with cake post, say, 1930, earlier cakes were completely different. So today we're going to do a fruitcake out of Mrs. Owens' cookbook. This is from 1883. There's probably close to a dozen fruitcake recipes in here, but we're going to do one called English Fruitcake because it ties back to this book from 1685. And I'm going to start out. It is a yeasted cake, as a lot of cakes in this time period and earlier were. No chemical leavening. Although by the point that this book was published, chemical leavening was readily available in the United States and Canada. But there were a lot of people that still clung to earlier ways and used yeast. So into the stand mixer, a pint of flour, yeast, salt, and water. And we'll just start mixing that together. Okay, so 1883, typical recipe, and it's really light on specifics. Starts out, it says, half a cake of compressed yeast, a pint of flour, make a sponge. I don't bake with compressed yeast. There's a couple reasons for that. Compressed yeast is live, and you need to use it quickly or use it consistently in order to buy it and keep it. And I just don't bake enough with yeast to do that. So I always have dry yeast. I brew beer. And so I use live yeast in brewing beer. And as you'll see in this earlier cookbook from the 1680s, we'll get to that in a moment. That is generally what they tell you to use, is beer yeast or the barm. So I use dry yeast, and I put the salt in there too because I find the salt dissolves faster or better earlier in the stage. And I used a 70% hydration. So I weighed the pint of flour and then worked out a 70% hydration in order to use the right amount of water. So we were, I'll have to go back to my notes. So don't quote me on this. I'll have to go back to my notes. 320 grams of flour, and I used 200 grams of water, or 200 milliliters of water. And I'm going to turn that off now. So the instruction is to let the sponge rise. I'm going to leave this for about a half an hour, and that's going to do a couple of things. The flour is going to hydrate. The dry yeast is going to activate. It'll start its enzymatic action to convert the starches in the flour into sugars that it can consume, and the rising will start. So 25, 30 minutes, and then we'll start to knead it. Now, this is called an English fruitcake. And I'm sure that most people by the end of this video are going to be screaming at the screen that no, it's not English, it's Italian. It's panettone, or a form of panettone. And you're not wrong. But when you, the farther back you go and you start looking at a broad depth of European cookbooks, you realize that it's pretty much similar across the board. All Europeans were eating very similar things in certain categories. And one of them is in this sort of enriched sweet bread with dried fruits in it. So when you get back to 1685, this is The Accomplished Cook by Robert May. My copy was published in 1685. It is a book that was published many years earlier. They just kept printing it. This printing, 1685, it has two cake recipes in it. Both cakes are essentially what we would call today fruit cakes or fruit cakes. They're leavened with yeast and they call for the barm of fresh ale. So that is, as you're brewing ale, in this time period, it would have been brewed in an open vessel. And that bubbly, frothy stuff that happens on top, you'd scoop that off and you'd use that for baking. Or you'd scoop that off and you'd take it home and you would mix it with other things in order to keep it growing in your kitchen over the course of a week so that you could just keep taking a little bit and baking with it. They're both enriched breads, which means they're using a fat, in this case, butter. Here it is butter or cream, and they put in dried fruits, dried sweet fruits or sweetened fruits like this citron. And this carries on. This is a very common type of cake, and it's odd to call something with yeast today cake, but even shortbread, Scottish shortbread, in this time period, used yeast. It was leavened with yeast. Okay, so it's been 25 minutes and you're not gonna see any rise, but the dough is hydrated. So we're gonna turn on and knead like bread. I'm gonna say that's good. So I'm gonna take it off the stand mixer. I'm gonna leave the beater in there. Just move this down, leave the beater in there, and I'm going to cover this over just like that, and I'm going to let that rise for about an hour, maybe hour and a half. Let it rise up, and then we have to beat in the mix-ins. Okay, so it's been an hour. Let's see, what do we got? The dough has risen. It's probably doubled in bulk. There really isn't a whole lot of dough here. Especially given how much stuff we're about to add to it. So, get this back on. The add-ins, the mix-ins. We've got white sugar. And so we'll get that white sugar in there and get it kneading together. It calls for shortening, and so I'm going to put in butter. Now, the butter's been sitting here at room temperature for probably 2 hours or more, so it's soft. And it's going to take a little while to work that into the dough, but it will work in. The sugar was white sugar. It's interesting that even in the 1685 book, it calls for white sugar. A lot of people seem to think that in the oldie days, it was always brown sugar. Not the case. White sugar was used for a lot of things, even back into the 1400s, the 1300s. Refined white sugar was a thing. Okay, I'm just gonna get in there and give that dough hook a bit of help. Get that butter. I'm gonna get that butter all mixed into the dough. Now, unlike most fruitcakes in this book or in the 1600s book, there's no spices. It does call for some flavoring, does call for some lemon extract, and we'll get that in, but it does call for fruit. And so in the 1883 book, it's asking for raisins, and so in go the raisins, and it's not specific on what kind of raisins. Cookbooks in this time weren't always very specific. They allowed you to sort of use what you could get. Doesn't say what kind of flour, use the flour that you can get. Doesn't say what kind of raisins to use the raisins you can get. It asks for citron. And it says 1 ounce of citron. I've got 4 ounces of citron. In this time period, 1883, the citron would have been the most expensive ingredient in this recipe and the most difficult to get. So 1 ounce kind of works 4 ounces today works for me because I really like citron in this type of cake. So in that goes. Next up are currants. And as much as I just said, the recipe book doesn't say what kind of raisins to use. Currants always get a specific call out. In English, just called currants. On US packaging, you'll often see it called Zante currants. We're in Canada, so English and French on the label. And in French, it's always raisins de Corinthe. They are Corinthian raisins. It is the Corinthian grape made into a raisin. Not really sure why in the United States they're called Zante. There's probably a story behind that. Anyway, calls for 3/4 of a pound. And I've got 375 grams in this pound. I need almost a full bag. So in those go. And then it does call for lemon extract. So teaspoon of lemon extract. Okay, so this is where not a lot of instructions. Typical. Doesn't tell me the pan to put it in. And at first I thought, you know, I've got these paper things for cooking panettone because I do make it quite a bit. But I've got this smaller round cake tin. And I think I'm going to bake it in this. And when I look at what's going on inside this mixing bowl, it's not coming together like a bread. It's not coming together like a panettone at all. It really does look like a cake batter. It's heavy. It's wet. That was a lot of butter and sugar that we put in there. So we'll get this into the cake pan, but we are going to let it rise because it says, when light, bake. So the expectation is that this is going to rise up in the pan. So there was no hope, you can see. There was zero hope that we were going to be able to work this into a dough ball or shape it like you would shape bread. So it says to, when light, bake. I've got the oven preheated to 350 degrees, ready to go on the baking. What have I got here? I'm just going to cover this with a clean towel. And we're going to let that rise. I'm going to come back in about an hour and take a look at it. I'll probably come back in a half an hour and look at it, then look at it in an hour. And we'll figure out how long to let it rise before it goes into the oven. I don't have enough room in this pan for it to rise double, so maybe like 1.5 times. I'll just keep an eye on it. Okay, it's been an hour, so let's check. Not expecting big things. Kind of like that. So here's a couple of things. Before we put this in the oven, a few things I want to talk about. There's probably people already down in the comment section admonishing me, saying, the recipe tells you to use shortening, you use butter. If you're thinking about vegetable shortening, if you're thinking about Crisco, in 1883, when this book is published, vegetable shortening, like Crisco, hadn't yet been invented, didn't exist. You have to start thinking, you have to forget what you know in 2023 and start thinking like you lived in 1883. Shortening includes butter. So in this time period, when they asked for shortening, they would have been asking for butter or lard made from pork fat or beef tallow. Margarine in 1883 had been invented already. But it wasn't made from vegetable oil. It was made from beef tallow. And even though it had been invented, it wasn't for sale yet in the United States, or widely for sale in the United States. There's a difference between invented and actually in the marketplace. Wasn't in the marketplace. Anyway, back to why this isn't rising. There's a lot of fat in this dough, and there's a lot of sugar in this dough. Two things that slow down the development of yeast. The third thing that slows down the development of yeast is salt, but there's not enough salt in here to really retard the growth of the yeast. But that amount of sugar and that amount of fat will really slow it down. The yeast is having a real hard time in there right now, trying to get going. But it's time to go into the oven. And I hear you. Yeast needs sugar to live. Yeast loves sugar. Yeast eats sugar. I love sugar too, but it'll kill you after a while.
Hey, Glen.
A lot of fruit. A lot of fruit.
That's a pretty... There's something very fancy about a round fruitcake.
It's just, well...
Well, because ours is always in a giant loaf.
Oh, giant.
It's we bulk make it, right? So...
I have no idea what to expect from this one.
It's a fruitcake.
It is a fruitcake. It's really leavened...
Light fruitcake.
Leavened with yeast.
Huh. So it's a fruit bread.
Hmm. I like fruitcake. It's not like our Christmas cake.
No, it's not. It's very fruity.
Mm-hmm.
Somehow it doesn't have that cloyingly sweet flavor that I often don't like with fruitcake.
Well, that's another problem with fruitcake, is you can't approach a fruitcake like a chocolate slab cake that you get from the grocery store for a kid's birthday party, where you could pack away half the cake in one sitting because it's light and it's fluffy and it tastes good. Fruitcake is meant to be eaten in very tiny doses.
No, I've had to adult myself into fruitcake because as a child it was too much, too rich, too... Never really liked it, which is why, of course, we had the jujube cake. But this would be another great substitute, although I do really like jujube cake. But
the jujube cake recipe is also on... I'll try to remember to link below. That's a very interesting cake.
It is nice.
I like that
a lot. I think my family would really like it because they all like fruitcake.
Yeah.
A little butter on it. Would just add a little or a little jam. Like it's something you could put a butter and jam with, right? Because it is a
the texture
more
is
of
really,
a fruit bread.
It's a very dense texture, like other fruitcakes. I really like that. I like the lemon, so it's got lemon in it.
Yes, I noticed the little. I of course want to slice more. I'm gonna slice some more.
Okay, so 1685. At the front.
We're getting a full lecture today.
At the front of this cookbook from 1685 is a bill of fare for Christmas Day and how to set the meat in order. So, the first course of this Christmas dinner has 20 components. Started with oysters, a collar of brawn, stewed broth of mutton marrow bones, a grand salad, a potage of caponettes, breast of veal, a boiled partridge, a chine of beef, minced pies, a jagot of mutton with anchovy sauce, a made dish of sweetbread, a swan roast. I thought the queen owned the swans. Or I guess now the king owns all the swans. Do you have to get his permission to hunt the swan? A pasty of venison. A kid with a pudding in his belly.
Is it like a haggis?
Or a goat, maybe?
Yeah, but with it in his belly, I kind of make it...
Yeah, like a haggis. Anyway, a steak pie. A haunch of venison roasted. A turkey roast and stuck with cloves. This is very interesting because this book, 1685, is... the first published English cookbook that has turkey and potatoes in it.
Ah.
Turkey, you won't find turkey in other cookbooks.
Good point.
And potatoes, even in 1685, a lot of people feared the potato. There's definitely no tomatoes in here because those were completely nobody. Made dish of chickens and puff paste. Two bran geese roasted, one larded. Two large capons, one larded, and a custard. That's the first course.
So it reminds me of when you go for those large multi-course meals and you have like this much of everything.
Of everything.
By the time you're done, you've tasted everything.
You're stuffed.
You're already full. So I don't know, is there a walk in between? Do they suggest which kind of games you play and second servings?
The second course of the same mess, same dinner. Then you would have oranges and lemons to start off your
fruit.
Second.
That makes sense. A little fruit.
A young lamb or kid.
No pudding this time.
No pudding in the belly. Two couple of rabbits, two of them larded. So I guess four rabbits. A pig. I don't know how to say that word, but you do something with the tongues. it contains a long S, so I'm not going to... Sucked. No. Sucked with tongues. Three ducks.
Soaked? No.
Three ducks. Three pheasants. A swan pie. Three braces of partridges. I don't know how many's in a brace. How many barley corns in a mile? A made dish of puff paste, bologna sausages, and anchovies, mushrooms, pickled oysters in a dish, 6 teals, a gammon of Westphalia bacon, 10 plovers, a quince pie, 6 woodcocks, a standing tart and puff paste with preserved fruits and pippins, etc. 6 dried neat's tongues, a sturgeon, and powdered geese jellies.
Is there more to this meal?
That is a meal. Like, that's a lot of stuff to be on a table. Now, to be fair, this particular chef did work in the grandest houses of England.
Yes, they clearly had a lot of people putting
that together. Putting out a giant meal on one of those really long tables that you would see. Our Christmas dinner is not going to be so grand.
No.
So, at this point...
And yet, it's going to be pretty darn fine.
It'll be great.
Fine fruit bread.
Because it's all about the people you're with. The food is part of it, but it's all about the people you're with. So, to everyone who's celebrating Christmas tomorrow, Merry Christmas from us. Thank you very much for watching. We hope that you can cook something this year that we've made and shared with you. And we'll see you all next week. Thanks for stopping by.
See you again soon.